Hello all, welcome to homeschool. We are with the chapter tissues. In my previous video, we have already completed about the plant tissues and also we discussed detailed things about the epidermis. And now coming to the next aspect of the chapter, that is animal tissues. Let us talk about the tissues present in animals. Okay. So, which tissue can do what job and everything we will discuss. And keep one point in your mind that animal tissues are not that simple as plant tissues. They are more specialized. They do more jobs on their own. Okay. So, actually the plant body is very simple compared to an animal body, guys. So, the plant tissues are very much simple in their structure, their function, and in everything they are simple. Not too much complicated. But animal tissues are not simple. Okay? Not simple in their structure. Not simple in their function or duty. Okay? So, let us discuss everything about animal tissues. Okay? Guys, imagine if this is a man, okay, I'm not drawing it properly, just try to imagine, okay. So, if this is a man, okay, and a human body can do so many things, especially the movements, right? Can you ever think that how is the movements possible with our body? So, how can we move our hand so easily? Say, to write something, I can use my hand very freely. I can walk with my leg, I can jump, I can run. Yes or no? And even breathing. What do you mean by breathing? Taking oxygen, giving out carbon dioxide. Say, when I breathe, the chest area moves. Yes or no? Say, something in the chest area is moving up, down. Yes or no? So, why is this movement happening inside? So, who is responsible behind all these movements, guys? During breathing, the chest area is going up, coming down. So, what is the reason? How I can move my hands so much freely? How I can walk with my legs very freely, very conveniently, right? So, how is this movement happening inside? Guys, there is a special tissue inside. Very, very special tissue inside. That tissue is called as muscles. There are muscles, guys, inside our body. Yes or no? So, these muscles are responsible for the movements. Okay. Say, muscle is a tissue. Tissue in the sense, group of so many cells. The muscle cells are very special cells, guys. Okay? See, when I breathe, the chest area is going up and coming down is because of muscles inside. Okay? See, I can lift my hand so much freely. I can run. I can do whatever I want with my hands and legs is because muscles are there inside. Okay? So, muscle is one important tissue, guys. Muscle is one important tissue that is responsible for all movements that are there inside a animal body. Okay, so all movements of animal body is due to this special tissue called muscles. Okay, fine. Okay, this is one tissue. Fine. And now, see, we breathe oxygen. Oxygen is going inside. That oxygen has to go to each and every cell of your body, guys. Each and every cell need oxygen. See, the cell which is present in your hair need oxygen. The nail cells need oxygen. The toe cells need oxygen. The fingers need oxygen. The cells in the nose need oxygen. Cells in the ears need oxygen. Okay. Each and every cell need oxygen. Whatever oxygen you are taking from your nose, no. Inside, that oxygen should reach to all parts. Okay, so who is carrying that oxygen to all parts? And you eat food. The nutrients which are there in a food should go to each and every cell, guys. Okay, whatever food you take, no, the nutrients, whatever are there in a food should reach to every cell. Like oxygen is necessary for every cell, nutrients are also necessary for every cell. So who is carrying nutrients? Who is carrying oxygen, nutrients, etc.? Various things are actually should pass from one part to another part of a body. So how is these things are passing inside our body from one area to another area? See, the oxygen should go to head area, oxygen should go to toe area, hair, it should go to nails, everywhere it should go. So who is carrying? Who is carrying? The blood is carrying here. Okay, so the blood will carry all the oxygen and nutrients from one part to another part. And in the similar way, the waste material also should be carried by blood only. Okay, got to know? So here blood is another important tissue, guys. Okay, so blood is actually a group of cells. Blood is a tissue. It has a very, very special cells inside. Got to know? So blood is another tissue here. Clear? And now, imagine you are hungry, very much hungry. The food is there in front of you. Okay, very much delicious food is there in front of you. Okay, say your brain automatically sends a signal. Your brain will tell, oh idiot, you are actually hungry. Food is there in front of you. Put your hand and take the food inside. Who will tell this? Brain will tell. Okay, say the signals are passed or the signals are actually given by a brain. Got to know? In a similar way, say for example, the moment I saw my friend, I definitely wave my hand. So who is telling my hand to move like this? The brain is telling. The brain is passing a signal. The brain is telling, oh, it is your friend, you have to wave your hand. So it automatically sends a signal to my hand. So hand automatically waves like this. You know, say the signals are transferred, carried, you know, from one place to another place inside a body. And this signal carrying work is done by, you know, nervous tissue. Signal carrying work is done by nerves, guys. Okay, there are so many nerves inside our body. Through these nerves only signals are passed from one area to another area inside a body. Okay. So, nerves are another example for tissue. Clear? And now, we have so many organs inside. We have heart inside. We have brain inside. We have stomach inside. Yes or no? We have kidneys inside. So, each and every organ will do some job. And they have to be protected. Yes or no? They should have a protective covering, guys. Yes or no? Our bones are there. Muscles are there. Everything has to be protected. So who will protect all these things? So who is the protective covering here? Who is the protective covering here? You know, there is a tissue called epithelium. There is a tissue called epithelium. Okay, say this is another tissue. Each and every organ should be safe, safely placed. It should have a safe covering. That safe covering is another tissue, guys. Okay, like this, our animal tissues are divided into four types. Very important, note it down. Animal tissues are divided into four types, guys. Okay, so what are they? The first one is epithelial tissue. epithelial tissue. Okay, epithelial tissue in the sense it is present everywhere inside a body, guys. Because every part has to be protected, no? Every part has a protective covering, guys. That protective covering is actually a kind of tissue. What is its name? Epithelial tissue. And the second one is connective tissue. Connective tissue. So here blood is an example for connective tissue. Okay, so blood actually connects one part to another part. You know, it carries so many things, so many materials from one part to another part. That is the reason blood is actually called as connective tissue. Right? Say the third one is muscular tissue. Muscular tissue is nothing but all about muscles, guys. I told you, each and every movement is due to muscles inside. So, all these muscles together called as muscular tissue. And the last and final type is nervous tissue. Nervous tissue. I told you, brain has to give signals for each and everything. Okay. So, how the signals are passed? Signals are passed through special tissue, guys. What is that? Nerves. Nervous tissue we are going to learn. So, we have to discuss in detail about epithelial tissue, connective tissue, muscular tissue and nervous tissue. First and foremost, let us discuss about epithelial tissue. See guys, coming to the first variety of animal tissue, that is epithelial tissue. You know, epithelial tissue makes an outermost covering. Outermost covering. I told you, there is kidney inside a body, heart inside a body, lungs inside a body. They should have a protective covering. Okay. Whatever minute things are there in this organ, they have to be protected with certain covering. So that outer covering, protective covering is what we call it as epithelial tissue. So that's why I'm writing. It makes an outermost covering and a protective tissue. It is a protective tissue in animal body. In animal body is called epithelial tissue, guys. Okay. The main purpose of epithelial tissue is to protect only. To protect various things that are there inside a human body or any animal body. Clear? And usually, tissue in the sense what? Made up of so many cells. So here, the cells are called epithelial cells. And these epithelial cells are tightly packed. Okay, next point I'll write is epithelial cells. Epithelial cells are tightly packed. Tightly packed in the sense, there is no gap between one cell and another cell. Clear? So, tightly packed in the sense, there is no intercellular spaces. Intercellular spaces. Okay? So, very tightly packed. Imagine this is one cell. This is one cell. This is another cell. You know, there is no space only. They are very much closely packed. Okay. So, that way the cells are arranged in a tissue. Clear? And the next point is epithelial. This is very important point. Epithelial cells are placed on basement membrane. Basement membrane. Okay. So, this is very important point, guys. Basement membrane. Clear? So, usually you will have one membrane initially. Imagine this is the basement membrane. Okay. So, wherever epithelial tissue has to be present, there actually you will have one basement membrane. So, only on the basement membrane, epithelial cells can be present. This is one cell, second cell, third cell, you know, fourth cell, fifth cell, sixth cell, like that many crores and crores of cells would be present. Okay, see, all these are epithelial cells, guys. Okay, epithelial tissue. See, the cells are closely packed. There is no gap between one cell and another cell. And all the cells are present on one basement membrane. You see? Okay, always there will be a basement membrane. This is what we call it as basement membrane. Very important. And actually, we have different types of epithelial tissue. So, different types of epithelial cells are present in different areas inside a body. Okay. And they do a different duty. Their job is also different only. Okay. We have so many organs inside. Right. Say in mouth area, one type of epithelial tissue is present. In stomach area, the other type of epithelial tissue is present. On a skin, the tissue, epithelial tissue is different. Like that, we have different epithelial tissues. Okay. And, you know, they actually perform different duties in a different ways. So let us discuss the types of epithelial tissue. Epithelial tissue. Okay. Whatever may be the type of epithelial tissue, the cells are always present on a basement membrane, guys. Okay. I'm going to discuss many types, but whatever may be the type, you know, the tissue is always present on a basement membrane and the cells are tightly packed and there are no spaces between the cell. These points are common for all types of epithelial tissue. Okay, the areas where they are located is different and the duty they perform is different. That's it. But the common points are these only, whatever may be the epithelial tissue. Say the first and foremost, we have squamous epithelial tissue. Squamous epithelial tissue. Second one is cuboidal epithelial tissue. And the third and important one is columnar epithelial tissue. Okay. So, our epithelial tissue is mainly divided into three types. Squamous epithelial tissue, cuboidal epithelial tissue and columnar epithelial tissue. Now, let us discuss about them one by one. Where they are present, where is squamous epithelial tissue is present inside a body and what job will it do, all that we will discuss. Okay, we will go initially with squamous epithelial tissue. You know, in squamous epithelial tissue, the cells are thin. Okay, cells are very thin and the cells are flat and they are irregularly shaped. Okay, and also they are permeable. What do you mean by permeable, guys? In the previous chapter we studied permeable membrane in the sense you will have a small holes where only few substances can go inside. Okay, only few substances can go inside through that membrane is called permeability. Okay, say this is the characteristics or features of squamous epithelial tissue. Actually speaking, there are two types of squamous epithelial tissue, guys. First one is simple squamous. And the second type is stratified squamous. Stratified squamous epithelial tissue. Okay, like this we have again two types of squamous epithelial tissue. Let us discuss about them in detail. See, simple squamous epithelial tissue is present in the lining of mouth, inside the mouth, guys. Okay, so if you open the mouth, you know, you will have a delicate covering, Yes or no? So in the buccals, you can see here and the upside, upper region, you know, there is a lining. So this lining is nothing but simple squamous epithelial tissue. So what I can write here is forms a lining. Simple squamous forms a lining of mouth. Okay, and there is an organ called esophagus. Esophagus. Okay, what do you mean by esophagus, guys? It is nothing but food pipe. Esophagus is nothing but food pipe. Okay, so whenever we consume a food, we consume food from our mouth, you know, it goes to throat area, and here in the chest area, you will actually have a long pipe, guys. Okay, through these pipe, you know, the food has to move, and here there is a stomach. Okay, so below the pipe, there is a stomach, and above the pipe, you actually have mouth. Okay, so between mouth and stomach, there is a long pipe. This pipe is what we call it as esophagus. In other words, it's a food pipe. Okay, and the lining in the sense what? Inside. Okay, you have a layer of cells, guys. Okay, this is how inside you can see inside the pipe, you know, you have a layer of cells, and this is what we call simple squamous epithelial tissue, right? And actually this is a single layer cells. Simple squamous is made up of single layer cells, guys. Just one layer of cells you have, you see. This side one layer, this side one layer, you know, it forms a lining, it protects actually. What is its duty, guys? Okay, it actually protects. Okay, it protects the mouth area, esophagus. Okay, and also it is present in alveoli of lungs. Where it is present? One more area you can find the simple squamous epithelial tissue, that is alveoli. Alveoli of lungs. What do you mean by alveoli of lungs, guys? In the chest area, you will have two structures called lungs. Okay, say where whatever oxygen you take, no, that oxygen will go to lungs. Okay, in the lungs, you will actually have a balloon like structure. You know, here the oxygen gas is filled, guys. It goes to lungs, no. Inside a lung, you have balloon-like structures. Inside this balloon-like structure, that oxygen gas stays. From there, it will get mixed up with the blood actually. Blood only should carry oxygen to all parts of the body, right? From where the blood gets that pure oxygen? From lungs. Inside a lungs, you have ball-like structures, balloon-like structures called alveoli. Okay, very delicate structure. And the lining of that alveoli also has squamous epithelial tissue. Simple squamous epithelial tissue. Okay, fine. And now, moving towards the stratified squamous epithelial tissue. You know, many layers of cells are present. Okay, here. Single layer cells, but here you will observe many layers of cells are observed. Cells are observed in many layers. So where do you find this stratified epithelial tissue? In skin, guys. Okay, actually skin has many layers, you know, whatever the layer we see with our naked eye is outermost layer. Inside this there are many layers. This is one layer of cell. Inside that one more layer of cells. Okay, all this is stratified epithelial tissue. Okay, so what is its function, guys? It prevents tearing of skin. Yes or no? Okay, say, and also prevents tearing of skin, prevents from damage. Tearing in the sense what? It prevents the breaking of skin. Right? And it protects us from harmful organisms, right? All the stuffs cannot enter through the skin, you know, because of this protective layer. What is that? Stratified squamous epithelial tissue is present in a skin in many layers. Got to know? So this is all about simple squamous and stratified epithelial tissue. And if you want to know their structure, you know, every epithelial tissue has a basement membrane. Yes or no? Imagine this is a basement membrane. On this basement membrane, you will observe a cells. Okay, say for example, this is how the simple squamous epithelial tissue looks like. Okay, inside a mouth, in the esophagus, you know, this is how first you will have some basement. Okay, first you will have some basement, guys. So on a basement, single layered cells are neatly arranged. That itself we will call it as simple squamous epithelial tissue. And what about the stratified? This is just one layer. Imagine this is one layer. On this layer, if I have one more layer, it is for your imagination, guys. Okay, on this one more layer, so many layers of cells are arranged on this basement membrane. Then we will call it as stratified epithelial tissue. Okay, I will show the picture also. At the end of the video, I will show all the pictures of all epithelial tissues. Okay, just try to remember. In the simple squamous, only one layer of cells would be there. In the stratified, strats in the sense what? If you have seen the pastries, cool cakes have you observed? Many layers are there, no? Many layers would be there. Just like that, many layer of cells forms stratified squamous epithelial tissue. Clear everybody? So that's all about squamous epithelial tissue. And coming to the next variety, cuboidal epithelial tissue. Second variety is cuboidal epithelial tissue. Okay, and here cells are cube-like. Cells look like a cube, guys. Each and every cell looks like a cube. Say, how do you draw a cube? Something like this. Yes or no? So, each and every cell. This is one cell. Another cell. Like that, crores and crores of cells are arranged in layers. That is called cuboidal epithelial tissue. Okay. Cells are cube-like and cells are long. Cells are long also. And where are they present? Present in salivary glands, thyroid glands, okay, and tubules of kidney, inside the kidney, you will have tubes, there are certain tubes, okay, so tubules also has this cuboidal epithelial tissue, okay. And what do you mean by salivary glands? Where are the salivary glands are present? Here, guys. Okay, we have a liquid inside our mouth. Yes or no? That is called saliva. That's very important for the digestion. Okay, say who will create this liquid? There are certain glands, knob-like structure here. That is called salivary gland. So the lining of salivary gland, see the inner lining. We have seen the lining in the sense what? Inside the structure. You know, the lining is made up of cuboidal epithelial tissue. Similarly, here we have one more gland, thyroid gland. Okay, inside the thyroid gland also you will have cuboidal epithelial tissue. Okay, cube-like, each and every cell looks like a cube, guys. Okay, and you know, what do they do? What is the main function of cuboidal epithelial tissue? To protect. Okay, to protect the glands from injury. Okay, and you know, this gives mechanical support. It gives a support to glands. Okay, where in whichever gland the cuboidal epithelium tissue is present, you know, this tissue is mainly to give a kind of support to the glands. The glands are very delicate structures, guys. They need a kind of support. They need a kind of flexibility. They need a kind of protection. Okay, for that purpose, we have this cuboidal epithelial tissue as a lining inside a gland. Clear? That's all about cuboidal epithelial tissue. And now let us discuss about columnar epithelial tissue. Coming to the columnar epithelial tissue, column in the sense what? Long things are called columns. Yes or no? So here the cells are pillar like. In this particular epithelial tissue, cells are pillar like. Pillar like. Okay. And they are wide and tall, guys. They are wide as well as tall. You know, where are they present? They are present in a lining. In a lining of stomach. Inside a stomach, you will find the columnar epithelial tissue as well as in intestine. In intestine also, you will find columnar epithelial tissue. You know how they look like? Imagine, and this is a basement membrane. I told you, all types of epithelial tissue will definitely should have a basement membrane. Okay, so they stay on a basement membrane. Basement membrane is just like a support, guys. Okay, this acts as a support for the cells to stay in close with each other. That is the main function of this basement membrane. This is a basement membrane, and this is how the cells are long. See, this is one cell, this is another cell, third cell, fourth cell, fifth cell, you know, this is a nucleus of the cell. See, cells are very much long. They look like a pillar, right? See, this is how the inner lining of the stomach, you know, stomach inner lining, inside the stomach, you know, you have columnar. First, you have a basement membrane. Okay. And after that, this columnar epithelial cells are present. Okay. Say, this is how inside the stomach, this columnar epithelial tissue is present. First, you have a basement membrane. On that only, these cells are present. Okay. And what is their main duty? What do they do? Here, along with the protection, protection is there. They protect. This tissue actually protect. Along with the protection, they secrete also. They will create certain chemical substances that are required for the digestion, guys. Okay, remember, along with the protection, they secrete certain chemical substances, certain liquids they will secrete, they will create. Okay, these liquids may be helpful for the digestion process. Okay, and also the cells absorb certain nutrients. Okay, so especially once the digestion is over in the stomach, actually the food will go to the small intestine, guys. Okay, the small intestine is a snake structure. It is connected to stomach. The food goes here, no? In the small intestine also, you have this columnar epithelial cells, pillar-like cells. Okay, so these pillar-like cells actually absorb the nutrients. Whatever nutrients are going from stomach to small intestine, no? There in the small intestine area, the nutrients will get absorbed. So who will help in the absorption of nutrients? Actually, this columnar epithelial tissue is helping. See, along with the protection, it is doing so many other jobs. What are the other jobs these guys are doing? They are actually secreting certain chemical substances. Yes or no? Secreting chemical substances, and they are helping in the absorption of certain nutrients also. Okay? And now, this is a very important point, guys. Whatever I'm writing now is the very, very important one. Okay? Note it down. If hair-like structures are present on columnar epithelial cells, और कॉलमनार एपिथीलियल टिश्यू, देन इट इज कॉल्ड सीलिएटेड एपिथीलियम, सीलिएटेड कॉलमनार एपिथीलियल टिश्यू. ओके, अंडरस्टूड? यू हैड गॉट वन मोर न्यू टर्म हियर. व्हाट इज दैट? सीलिएटेड कॉलमनार. When do you call a columnar tissue as ciliated columna? Whenever you have hair-like structures. Okay? See, this is normal columnar epithelial tissue, isn't it? See, here at the top, if you have hair-like structure like this, hair-like structures, these hairs can move, front and back, you know. This is what we call it as cilia. Hair-like structures are called cilia. If cilia are present, then that columnar epithelial tissue is called ciliated columnar epithelial tissue. Understood? Cilia means hair-like structures. Okay? If hair-like structures are not there, then it is just called as columnar epithelial tissue. But if this hair-like structures called cilia are there, then it is called ciliated columnar epithelial tissue. So where does this ciliated epithelial tissue is present? You know, it is present in respiratory tract. Present in respiratory tract. Okay, respiratory tract in the sense our windpipe. Just like the food pipe, esophagus is called food pipe, I told. Like that, wind pipe also will be there behind the esophagus. That is called respiratory tract. Okay. Say, what is the use of this hair-like structure? You know, it helps. It helps in the movement of mucus. What do you mean by mucus, guys? Mucus is that colorless, jelly-like substance present in the nose. What we call it as kapha. Yes or no? So, for the movement of this colorless substance, you know, if it has to come outside, you know, the cilia will help. This hair-like structures will flush the mucus outside, will push the mucus outside. Okay, and if any foreign substances entered inside a respiratory tract, any fungus, bacteria, or many microorganisms which are there in the air, in case if they enter, they can also be pushed outside, flushed outside with the help of cilia. Okay, so along with the protection, how it is helping in the respiratory tract? It is helping in the movement of mucus. Okay, mucus is that colorless liquid. Clear? So that's all about the different types of epithelial tissue. Now let us see the pictures of all the different types, and let us see how this ciliated columnar epithelial tissue is helping in the movement of mucus. Yes, these are some examples of epithelial tissue, different types of epithelial tissue. Observe the picture of simple squamous. This is simple squamous. Single layered cells are present, isn't it? So it is present in the lining of mouth, food pipe, you know, in delicate organs. The outer covering is made up of simple squamous, okay? Or inner lining is made up of simple squamous. You can see single layer cells. And they are present on a basement membrane. You can observe this sky blue color structure below, right? This is what basement membrane. And coming to the stratified squamous, you see many layer of cells are present. This is one layer, this is the second layer, on that you have the third layer, fourth layer, like that. Many layers of cells are present on a basement membrane. So such a tissue is called stratified squamous. It is present in the skin because the skin has to protect from many dangers, isn't it? The skin should protect from damage, injury, etc. So skin will have many layers. That's the reason skin is made up of stratified squamous epithelial tissue.
And this is cuboidal epithelium, guys. The cells are there in the shape of a cube, okay? And this is columnar epithelium. See the cells, they are very much tall and wide, pillar-like cells, isn't it? Present on a basement membrane. And you see here, this is ciliated columnar epithelial tissue. Columnar epithelium only, but on that you have hair-like structure called cilia. So it is helpful in the movement of mucus. See how this hair is helping in the movement of particles? See, the hair is actually pushing the particles away. Usually this is present in a windpipe, that is respiratory tract, where mucus would be there, it has to flush away, isn't it? So who will help in flushing away the mucus? This hair-like structures, right? So this is what we call cilia. So ciliated columnar epithelial tissue it is. So that's all about different types of epithelial tissue. So in my next class, let us talk about the connective tissue. Clear? Till then, keep revising the concept and see you in the next class. Thank you.